go, no go for launch.
Retro, go flight. Booster, go flight.
Hey, Harry, you know we're sitting on 4 million pounds of fuel, one nuclear weapon, and a thing that has 200,000 moving parts built by the lowest bidder.
The clock is ticking, and Bruce Willis is on a mission to save the world from a giant asteroid in Armageddon. One of the movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert, and we'll take a look at the newly restored version of Gone with the Wind. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Armageddon is appropriately named because while you're seeing it, you will feel as though you've been in combat, visual combat and oral combat. This could have been the movie that was shown to Malcolm McDowell in A Clockwork Orange to make him sick of violence. Am I communicating? We're talking nonstop action and noise. That doesn't make it a bad movie. Rather, the audacity of the way it has been put together eventually becomes almost amusing. The situation is this. An asteroid the size of Texas is hurtling toward Earth. Deep core oil driller Bruce Willis is called upon by NASA chief Billy Bob Thornton to help save the world.
We're a little short on time here. Will you help us?
All they got to do is drill.
That's it.
No spacewalking, no crazy astronaut stuff.
Just drill.
So Willis recruits his own men, including Ben Affleck and Steve Buscemi. Their mission, land two space shuttles on the big rock, drill holes for nuclear bombs, and blow the sucker off its trajectory.
The United States government just asked us to save the world. Anybody want to say no?
Regarding the human element in the film, as little as there is, I was struck by the impact of young actress Liv Tyler as Willis's daughter and Ben Affleck's girlfriend.
Do you think it's possible that anyone else in the world is doing this very same thing at this very same moment?
I hope so. Otherwise, what the hell are we trying to save?
Now, each element of their plan serves as its own action film, and director Michael Bay, whose last picture was The Rock, which also was strikingly noisy, dares us to relax in Armageddon. Armageddon is blaringly intense. By the end, I didn't care whether Earth was saved as much as I wanted to survive myself. But again, if you get into this mood with this picture, I was laughing. That's a strangely entertaining and amusing experience. If you can stop blinking and, of course, take your fingers out of your ears. So a weird, truly weird thumbs up from me.
Well, we saw the same picture, but my thumb is way down. I wanted to escape from this movie. I didn't care if the asteroid hit the Earth or not. I was afraid the movie was going to hit me. And, you know,
it's cut.
So quickly.
Absolutely.
That there's no a stretch of action that makes any sense or is comprehensible in any way. This movie, the entire movie, is cut together like a coming attractions trailer.
Yeah, no question.
And it was bewildering.
Or the TV ad for the film.
And it was aggressive and it was assaulting and it was too noisy. And I liked The Rock. I gave The Rock thumbs
up.
Oh, you
did? Okay.
But this film, to me, doesn't have any kind of an arc or any kind of dramatic interest. And when it stops for drama, like when they're all saying goodbye to each other, before, you know, like seconds are ticking down. If they don't get that bomb ready in another 20 seconds, the Earth ends, and they're saying goodbye to each other on television. I couldn't understand that.
Let me give people one piece of advice. If you go to a multiplex and it has Armageddon in it, do not go to a movie next door.
Because there
will be tremendous audio bleed. But it's awful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really,
well, it was too much for me. I just felt that it was...
But I was smiling.
Overkill. Okay.
A strange split vote on Armageddon. The film's sound and fury eventually won me over in a laughing way, but Roger disliked it for exactly the same reason.